Does anyone else have crippling depression?
Yeah, yes. How did you know?
Oh, the context of that is going to be totally lost when it comes time to put that on YouTube.
There's context for that? What was the context?
You were just saying, like, we were waiting for Bird, but we won't want Bird to say anything funny. And then I start the podcast with the least funny thing I can think of.
Oh.
That was probably the opposite of what you were saying before, though.
I thought that was just like a...
All right, welcome. Four Nerds, Save the Universe.
It's completely random humor that comes out of nowhere.
Anti-humor.
No.
Nerds, Save the Universe. God damn it, I'm trying to get this rerailed.
Welcome to Podcast 22.
No,
we're here
do it.
With Colonel RPG, our first guest ever, I think.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah.
We haven't had random changing guest people since like before the previous podcast even. Like, wait,
right.
I was the
only one
original
when
four
I was
episode run.
Yeah, when I was doing the Let's Play podcast, I was like doing constant guests. That's exhausting, and I never want to do that again.
Yeah, I'm sure it's like, well, we could talk about anything, but instead we're going to interview this person.
to organize somebody every single week.
Well, it wasn't just somebody, it was everybody but me. And so, like, I had to,
I had a list
of, like, a couple hundred people.
I forgot you ran a podcast where you were the only cast member.
Yeah, and I would cycle people out and stuff like that, which was cool, but I had a list of, like, a couple hundred people that I had to pick from, but also I had to, like, kind of vet them, you know, how long they've been doing it, what's their quality, stuff like that. So it's effectively Unsucky Sunday, but you're actually making a video with them as opposed to just reviewing their stuff later. And so it was a nightmare, especially because it was kind of the thing that, Keith, you had done, like, a podcast with two new Let's Players and, like, kind of coached them on how to Let's Play, right?
Yeah, they both gave up and didn't make it very far. It feels really good.
Everybody from those podcasts pretty much just quit, and I was just like, well, this is kind of pointless.
Mm-hmm. Mm.
Yeah, I was going to say I wanted some of that coaching, but then maybe I don't.
Yeah.
Wow. Didn't go great.
Well, the coaching was not the reason why they quit. The reason why they quit was just because they weren't committed enough.
The hard reality I tried to give is just the fact that there's a lot of dedication and luck involved, and that proved true.
Colonel RPG is here, Colonel being like the military position,
not like the operating system or the inside of a food thing. Three guesses what kind of content he covers on his channel as a Let's Player is
mostly CRPGs, right? Computer role-playing games. Mostly Western stuff.
I thought CRPG was classic, not...
Well, it stands... I guess you can make the acronym for whatever, but I think it mostly stands for computer role-playing game. Because it came from the distinction between the normal role-playing games, which is the pen and paper, I guess.
Oh, yeah, your D&D.
Yeah, you're right. And, it is computer role-playing game. And the first one was Ultima. At least,
yeah, it's just sort of a catch-all for that whole isometric point-and-click style.
I honestly hadn't thought about that, but that makes perfect sense.
Yeah, the history of RPGs in computer is actually a little bit complicated to define. I think the first one usually is Akalabeth. I think in 1972 or something like that. It was a first person.
Oh, he's good. You've got a good guess.
Yeah.
What are you checking? I'm not checking.
No, just keep going.
Are you
just
in the middle of fact checking him or something?
No.
But feel free to though.
He's teaching me things. I'm learning.
I think Bird has a new favorite.
Yes.
It just evolved over the years, and it took a little while to start, I guess, as video games did in general. But isometric role-playing games are not that old, all things considered. People tend to think that it's old technology. Well, in comparison to the first computer role-playing games, I think it's actually quite innovative and stuff like that. But I guess, you know, these days, I play a little bit of everything.
Okay, before we go too much further, you're Portuguese? Or...
Yes.
Okay.
Yeah.
I was like, you have an accent, and it's definitely not... not from American...
I was born in Portugal. I live in Portugal. Never left the country, basically.
You haven't even left Portugal? Not even to travel?
Probably a little bit to Spain every once in a while, but, you know, it's just...
Wow.
Like, a couple hundred miles away. Not much. Unfortunately, I would like to travel, though, but just hasn't presented the opportunity, I guess.
So I went on your channel to see what you were like, and I saw that you're playing Stardew Valley. Would you say that Stardew Valley is an RPG?
No, no, he's got the RPG mod on, so he levels up.
Is there a level? Oh, I see.
That's actually a Stardew Valley skin for Fallout 2.
He romances the girl that lives in the trailer plus one sex appeal. No.
I guess he doesn't go for that. He's not a pen. Okay. Who are you romancing in Stardew Valley then?
Who's I think it's though? Abigail. I think
Abigail?
It's Abigail,
oh,
yeah.
Man.
she likes it's chocolate fine. Cake. Who doesn't like chocolate cake?
Yeah, she eats rocks. She eats quartz.
She does.
that's what she rocks. Likes.
I gave her a diamond. Just, I was hungry. Yeah,
never ending story.
Yeah, I play a little bit of everything, though, kind of centered on role-playing games, sure, but like I have Heroes of Might and Magic, strategy game, but...
I love those games.
I suck at it so much. People just keep telling me. I am bad.
My favorite part of Heroes of Might and Magic is that I think it's the game... It's the one strategy game I've ever played that mimics real life the most, in that if you're playing Heroes of Might and Magic and you randomly spawn on top of a gold mine, you win.
I was about to bring that up because like it has the civilization issue where you kind of want to keep re-rolling the dice on spawning your world until you get a good spawn point, and that massively changes the entire game.
I give that game a hard time because I really do have a soft spot for it, but it is so broken in so many different ways.
I'm playing the third one though, and I'm playing the campaign as well. Never played the skirmish mode or
you've missed a lot of what makes that game.
Unforgiving.
broken. So the campaigns are actually pretty fun in Heroes of Might and Magic, but I played a lot of the skirmishes back in the day with my friends, and it was just like, oh, great, you spawned on top of, like, your primary resource and a gold mine, so you're, like, tier 4 already, and I have, I have a dude.
So pretty much our experience with Stellaris, then.
Yeah, you quickly realize why all the popular RTSs clearly spawn you in a cookie cutter base with the same like crystal and Vespian gas things and whatever that are just always there.
Yes.
Because when you randomize it like any like 4X game, for example, it's just like you can just lose because of the first second of the game.
Yeah, that's very true. That's why probably there's a lot more of a competitive scene for StarCraft than there is for Civ 4,
yeah,
for example.
Although the randomization makes for a more interesting game than
rather watch a StarCraft game than I would ever watch a Civ game.
No,
personally.
Yeah. Within their genres and pacings and stuff, but that's for like that's kind of a symptom of different stuff.
Yeah, I guess so.
It's interesting. For a long while, I knew about StarCraft competitive gameplay, but I never watched anything. And I know how to play StarCraft.
Now you're a Let's Player.
Well, it's just the transition, I guess, from somebody that plays video games to somebody that plays them on the internet is a funny story, I guess. But when I watched my first competitive StarCraft game, it's really close to watching sports game in any other sense. But you don't really get that impression without actually watching it, which is interesting.
Absolutely. I felt that way. The first esports game I ever watched was Dota 2. And it totally like clicked instantly why it's called esports, because especially if you're watching with like a big crowd, it has the exact same emotional highs and lows that you get as a spectator of an actual sporting event.
Yeah, I totally see that. I guess it depends on the game to the extent where you get that, but StarCraft is really good for that. No wonder it got so popular in Korea as an esports game, I guess. Mm-hmm.
I've watched a little bit of competitive StarCraft 2. I haven't seen any competitive StarCraft 1 except for like a GIF here and there. But StarCraft 2 it's exhilarating. You know, if you get really into it, you're like, oh my god, every single moment is like so intense and you're so with it.
Yeah, it's a strategy game in the middle of it all. Yeah. So
it's kind of like watching Wander play Slime Rancher. You're just like, oh my god, he's going to get that pink slime. He's going to get shit out of that slime. Oh no, the slime jumped
over
a wall.
He totally missed that lucky slime on episode 6. Oh.
Dude, I actually got a message the other day like being really harsh on me for like my decision-making in Slime Rancher. And I'm like,
yeah.
What?
Listen, I've gotten like, those comments for Sonic the Hedgehog and Alone in the Dark 2008.
I got them in Stardew Valley.
No one should be defending, and they'll still be like, like they'll be criticizing your micro.
Yep. Bird slash RPG, in like the first spring, there's like one kind of secret crop that you can get from like the festival. Was it like strawberries or something?
Yeah, you get the strawberry seeds festival.
I saw them and I was like, I don't have enough money and I don't have any like field space, so I'm not going to bother. And like very consistently, that was something people were just absolutely like just shaming
me
for.
Yeah, because all they gave a shit, they didn't give a shit until they like heard like this is what you can do. Because like nobody... You don't know that's there when you play Stardew Valley unless you're reading the wiki and, like, heard about it ahead of time. Because there's no indication, there's going to be this extremely expensive crop on day 8 that you can only get once a year, and it's really valuable the next year. And that's that's all the ammo you need to,
you're not supposed
on somebody.
You're not supposed to blend it in the first year? Because that's what I did. I got lucky enough.
You're definitely not supposed to plant it in the first year. You fucking noob. I can't fucking believe you. Get it's the like fuck off my podcast.
It's like when someone loads up like my part one of my Zelda playthrough 2 months after release, and I was like, oh my god, what's wrong with you? You're going past all the secrets, and it's like, you're supposed to learn over the course of the next like 100 hours what those secrets look like in that game.
Mm-hmm. But no, what you're supposed to do with the strawberries is if you plant them the same year, aren't getting the... Because you're planting them with only 3 weeks left in the season.
That's right.
So you're actually like cutting down on your total amount of profit, which you would know if you weren't a fucking moron.
I just saw them. I wanted strawberries. But then they didn't give me a kitchen yet, so I can't make them with... Nah, it doesn't matter. Got all these recipes and I can't make them.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Yeah, but
so yeah, what made you start? Your channel, Colonel RPG.
Oh, it's a long story. It's got I guess there's a lot of aspects, but the main one is that I love role playing games, and there's not a whole lot of YouTubers doing role play games. Not just the big ones, I guess. I'm currently enjoying a lot The Witcher 3 on stream though, but doing highlights for YouTube. But you know, old stuff like Fallout 1 and 2 and I don't know, just stuff like that, like the Age of Decadence, the indie games, that indie RPGs, I guess, that barely anybody covers, but that I just have a heck of a time with it, and I saw an opportunity.
Yep. Yeah, I really enjoy a lot of those early like Black Isle titles.
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
And just so many of those RPGs in the computer back then, like Icewind Dale. Planescape Torment, that was one of my favorites. God, I love that game. Fallout 2, like you mentioned, was actually one of the first games of that genre I ever played.
Yeah,
and,
me as well.
It was great. I think my favorite part of Fallout 2 was the very first thing I did was sequence break the shit out of that game without even knowing it. I just went straight south from the town, and I wound up in Enclave. I wound up in the Enclave base. That was the very first place I went to, and I got like the best equipment in the game within the first like 10 minutes of the world map opening up, and I was like, this is a good game.
That's going to be really cool to do, but when a game just lets you do stuff, though. Like, like Zelda,
it's a beautiful thing.
I have 46 episodes of Zelda, and I haven't met Impa, which is the first objective you get after the tutorial.
That's the mark of a good game.
It's great. You could just go do stuff. It's great when that kind of option's given to you. It gets messy though in a game like Wasteland 2, where they're trying to recapture that kind of stuff, but then the game can genuinely break itself if you don't follow its quest like note to note. Sometimes was your first playthrough Neo Scavenger on YouTube?
Yes, my first episode was Neo Scavenger. I just love that game. It's another indie. It's almost I don't know if you can call it an RPG. I guess it's got a little bit of that. But I saw it on Splattercat's channel, and I found it through there, and I was like, I want to play this game. And
I tried playing that game, and just for the life of me, I could not.
What was it, the cats?
Oh, no, there's Dogman, I think.
Yeah, Neo Scavenger is like...
That Neo Scavenger, okay.
Yeah. Like, the concept
behind it
is neat.
You were talking about that kitty cat game that you were playing yesterday.
you're thinking of the cat games. God, that game's hilarious.
So based on the day there, then you're 2 weeks away from your 2 year anniversary of your channel.
Indeed, indeed. It's been 2 years already, and I'm still enjoying it. I was going to say I'm still enjoying it as much as at the beginning. I was going to lie there. No, I'm enjoying it more than ever, I guess.
Yeah. That's good.
Yeah, just absolutely.
Liar.
No, I'm not. I'm just, it's the more, I guess, the more you learn how to relate to the games that you play while talking, I guess, the better you can take that pleasure out. It's a different experience, I found. Because I talk a lot. I like talking a lot, like just going on tangents. I'm currently playing through...
Boy, is this the business for you.
Pretty much.
You chose well.
Yeah, I guess some people don't like that, though, but I try to keep it under control,
they
I guess.
Don't. What a surprise people don't like something.
Yeah. It's true. It's, you know, it's for those who enjoy it, but I'm playing... You guys mentioned this game in a podcast a few weeks ago, Torment Tides of Numenera. I think Keith said something about it. Yeah. You ended up not playing it on the channel. It was a very busy month. I'm having so much fun with that game, but I do go on a lot of tensions because the game, it's a sort of game that really puts you in situations and shows you people that it's really
this was the
I guess.
Spiritual successor of Planescape Torment you're talking about, right?
Exactly.
I was barely following the development of that.
Is it a spiritual successor or just a genuine sequel?
No, it's not. It doesn't even take place in the same setting.
Okay, so it has because they don't have Planescape rights, probably.
Yeah. Actually, right.
Because Planescape's like an external thing, right?
Planescape is a D&D setting.
Okay, that's that makes sense.
Mm-hmm. And Tides of Numenera is a different pen and paper RPG. Written by the same guy that wrote Planescape. But I think it backfired on them because a lot of people are expecting the same sort of experience, same sort of game that Planescape Torment was. And
well, the very cool thing about the Planescape IP that was afforded to them, and I know nothing about Planescape Numenera. Mm-hmm. What was that? Something like that. The thing that made Planescape really cool was you could like walk these different planes of existence and stuff, and there were these portals just kind of all over the place, and you would just like you would like walk around and you'd find like this wormhole to this new galaxy and stuff like that. So did they have that in this game?
That totally does sound like a Myst CRPG.
I could totally see that comparison.
So Kernel RPG is probably right about the people expecting something else, because the first review you find on Steam is a negative review from someone saying Planescape Torment remains one of my top five all-time favorite games.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Like, that's kind of in a nutshell.
Nearly every single negative review mentions Planescape Torment, and I'm not saying that it's wrong to say that. They did only include the Torment name for marketing reasons, because it has no connection whatsoever. What I think they did wrong, though, is that they kind of looked at Planescape Torment and they said, okay, this game has lots of text. Let's make the best game we can make with lots of text. And they went overboard with that.
How do you go overboard? Planescape Torment already went overboard.
It
had 7 million words.
No, it's not as much. But they really go overboard with Numenera. But I think the end result, if you take it for what it is, I think it's really... it works well. I think they did a good job, but it is not a spiritual, not necessarily a spiritual successor to Planescape.
That's a shame,
a lot of people.
But I guess I probably should have seen it coming because I never heard anyone talking about it.
We'll see how In Exile's trajectory goes, because there was pretty similar feedback for Wasteland 2 when it came out, which they made, and which is also a spiritual successor. Oh, actually, that one was just an actual sequel. So it was the first Wasteland, but a lot of people were like, this isn't a Wasteland. It was a lot of people's response, basically.
Well, who wouldn't want the original Wasteland again?
Oh, God, it looks like a nightmare. But what they got was another game that basically made XCOM as their combat model, which seems to be the popular way of a lot of RPGs handling things, because we have now the Wasteland series and the Shadowrun series are both like... these text adventure, walk around, talk to people with adventures, where the moment combat starts, it transforms into XCOM. Mm-hmm. And then I don't know if everyone's really on board with that.
Yeah, it's really tricky because I think in terms of Wasteland 2, in Wasteland 2's case, I think it was more about outright just the quality of the game. I felt, when I played it the first time, I felt that it was, as you were saying before, it's not open. You can break the game easily if you just walk around, and that was a problem, and it's still a problem in the director's cut. But for what it is, it's an okay game. I feel that there's some interesting characters and situations, but it could be so much more. I'm looking forward to their third, because they're developing Wasteland 3 right now.
Yes.
Yeah.
Which has the most confusing feature list that I read. Like when it talks about like asynchronous co-op, I'm like, wait, what are you saying? Are we gonna like would Juan and I be in the same world when we're not playing at the same time? And like, can we like make each other miss story points? Like,
yeah, somebody will play through, and then when you get there, their ghost appears, and you have to play faster than them.
Like there might be a detailed description of that by now, because it's been a while since the initial pitch happened. But at the time,
I didn't expect that.
I was literally like, "What are you talking about with your game?" I'm like, "What is?" Like, I get the basic part of Wasteland 3, where it'll be like a sequel to Wasteland 2 and more content, more gameplay. But when it talked about the new features, I was like, "I cannot interpret that based on how I know video games as of today."
Yeah, their company has the problem is that In Exile has a backtrack. I guess is it backtrack the word of doing that
history.
History. Of doing that. Just, basically, they go about their Kickstarter campaigns in a little bit of a mess, and they never really explain much.
It's a shame, because that company has some of the most creative people in the whole video game industry, and they're able to find their footing.
Yeah, a lot of them have been leaving the company, actually. Not everybody, but it's been a problem for them. I expect things, but...
So I'm looking at this description real quick of the multiplayer, and they talk about people being able to work cooperatively or against each other in the same world, like seemingly real time.
It's Wasteland 3 Dark Souls.
Which game is this?
It seems like in Wasteland 3, you might be able Wasteland to make 3. Two separate squads in the same world that are working at the same time in real time, but like maybe even in different locations and like working against each other's interests and stuff like that. Like you could just the way it sounds, you might be able to arrive at a settlement and find out the other team already screwed with it or something. Like, I don't even.
We'll
see when it comes out.
I can't wait to try that, if only because it would be really funny for one session to like just take two or four of us and just ruin a world. And they'd be that was stupid. Let's work together next time.
Is we should find a way to like min-max our efforts to ruin Keith's playthrough.
Yes.
I would have to make like separate playthroughs for that, probably. Which sounds like a nightmare in its own right.
Wow, what the hell is going on with my webcam? It just made me look so white.
You do that with Dark Souls, Keith.
Yeah, but Wasteland 2 was an ordeal to get through. That was a big one.
It was a big game.
There was neat stuff, but also like very clear moments of like kind of having to fight the game to get through it, because like there was moments where it would kind of fall apart moment to moment. One of the biggest ones was actually like the final hurdle is like, you beat the final encounter of the game, and there's like a ticking clock for an explosion to go off. But it's a CRPG, so you're like, how do I get there in time? You're trying to do skill checks to open doors, and like trying to deal with the fact that there's a tick tock while that's like the clock just won't stop counting down. Like even when like dialogue is happening, like I think they made a weird move at one point of like having ambient dialogue where a guy is sitting there and just talking, and you can hear them when you're standing next to them. So your RPG instinct is to stand there and wait for him to finish talking, but then you don't have time to finish the level before you die.
I have a very powerful tool.
We had that happen in Phantasy Star. That was really annoying.
never played Phantasy Star though. Yeah.
It was like an old MMO, but
we had a timed mission
to go get like four gene samples or something like that, and we just barely made it. And it's like, congratulations, you got the thing, but like it had to go through some dialogue for flavor.
Oh right, we lost because it took too long to turn the quest in.
It was one of those where it's like, hey, you got the thing, and we're gonna do this with it, and this, and this, and this, and in the middle of it, it just pops up, you failed the quest, returning to mission hub, and it's like, what?
And the whole time you were talking there, I was just yelling at you, like, Wander, turn it in, turn it in, turn it in, turn it in, and then we failed it, and I think we actually stopped playing the game after that.
Yeah, that was the last time we played the game, because it was...
Not for want of wanting to play it more, it's just like, we all got too busy, it took precedence.
Yeah, I mean, we had spent like an hour
for me in Wasteland 2 was when the dialogue made me fail the ending of the game, I had to replay the entire final fight.
Ooh! It's like the opposite
That's
of
bad.
A quick time
the
event.
Game was mean to me.
Yeah.
The weirdest thing that happened for me recently was actually in Tides of Numenera. There was a quest that had a decision. Basically, you had to choose either to help the guy or help whoever that guy was trying to kill. And I chose to help the guy that was the victim there. And then I went back to the guy that gave me the quest, and I expecting like him to just scream at me and just be upset. No, he was thankful that I helped him. So the quest triggered the wrong way, and basically I got both rewards. But
yeah,
I don't remember getting. Yeah, that was a good one, but I don't remember getting any.
This sounds like the issue with Mass Effect 2, where Conrad Werner would just forget what dialogue choice you chose with him in the first previous game, and he would just act like you pointed a gun in his face and threatened him. And for all future games, they just glitched that one out.
Yeah, they just failed variables, I guess. That's how programming goes.
I actually have like weird programming stuff to bring up about specifically Mass Effect Andromeda, because I've been playing through that, and there's some really weird issues with like continuity and basic like scene structure and things like that. So when you're playing that game, first of all, like, the old BioWare games, the older ones like Mass Effect and Dragon Age, both had problems not like problems in the game itself, but a problem for the developers to overcome was the idea that certain characters could be not in your party or in your party at any given moment, and you have the option to not recruit almost every single character in each of those stories, which leads to crazy variables, and they were like, we're up to the challenge, let's just do it right, and they did it. Mass Effect Andromeda tries to sidestep the problem by making, as far as I can tell, every single character a mandatory party member that joins just at a specific part of the story, no matter what, and they still messed it up. What happens is they failed to do basic script checks as far as like whether or not you've gotten to certain ports of the game or whether or not you've met certain characters yet. So
wait. Okay, keep going.
So. On a slight side thing, one bigger thing is that you meet an alien race in the game, and at the very, very beginning of the game, before you've ever met them, you can already give your land vehicle their paint pattern that's named after them that you've never met before. But on a more immediately weird thing, I had the specific case where I got a message about characters talking about setting up a poker game, and the poker game involved the alien character that I've never recruited yet or met a single member of the entire alien race of yet, so it's just a name, and I'm like, who? But then once that happened, other people have been telling me what happens in their game, and one of the other ones is that, like, if you meet PB and Drac on the first planet, and if you recruit PB, then leave and leave the planet... PB will already be living, she'll already be hanging out in her little escape pod as her home base, despite never having the scene yet of where she goes to the escape pod, which will still happen later as if it's a new thing, even though you've seen her in the escape pod before. But also, she'll talk about Drac if you talk to her, who you've never met yet and is not in your party. And like, there's like a bunch of really bad scripting things where the game can't keep track of who's in your party, even though they sidestep the complication of letting you not recruit people.
See, I was in my head picturing something a whole lot worse, where, like, some NPC is like, Sarah, good to see you, and Daryl, you're doing well, and then there's, like, some aliens like, ha, and you're like, I've never recruited this person before.
Yeah, that's probably, I think, I would imagine that's probably the hardest stuff to do in an RPG.
Yes, and it managing your story and pruning your, like, you know, branches so that it's still cohesive is... really, really hard.
It's
so
just one of those things that
you
really
can always
seals
just
the deal
say,
on this not
yeah, you
actually
can always just say
being
screw
fireware.
It, and then not, you know.
But it doesn't necessarily have to be an RPG, I guess. Even just adventure games, I guess. You're playing, Keith, you're playing Horizon Zero Dawn, I think it is. Didn't you have something similar like that in that game? I don't remember, though. I've been watching your Let's Play, but...
Like, was there a continuity problem in Horizon Zero Dawn?
Yeah, I think so. Didn't somebody say
feels... of one?
It feels disjointed to some degree, but that's only because the game itself has
content dials, I guess.
Well, because it's like such because it's such of a shoot. What's the example? I guess it's such an open world game that like if you're not playing them back to back, or if you are playing every mission back to back, the story starts getting really weird and awkward feeling.
Oh, I just had one. I just remembered the one from Horizon Zero Dawn that happened really recently, is that you get to an enemy encampment, because the game has enemy encampments throughout it that you can wipe out and clear them out, and they become friendly encampments because they can re-inhabit it and stuff. And you also reach a story chain where you get sent on a series of bounty hunting missions to kill three people and take them out. Then there are these various locations being all maniacal villains and stuff. One of them is within one of those enemy encampments, but I took out the enemy encampment first, then got the bounty hunter mission, which still was located in the enemy encampment, but it was no longer an enemy encampment, but a bunch of friendly soldiers. So this guy was sitting on top of this building and holding three people hostage and seemingly threatening to execute them all, while just surrounded with friendly guards and villagers not acknowledging them in any way.
Yeah. That's awesome. That's I wasn't thinking of that one because I don't think I've seen that episode yet, but
it
that's
might not
sort
be
of,
up yet.
Yeah, that's the that sort of stuff. Funny. I mean, it's just really hard to make games because of that, but yeah. That's what makes good games as well, right? Just being able to have a world that reacts to your actions. I feel anyway.
That's what makes it interesting. That's what Zelda's really good at, actually, is that like I'm actively ignoring the main quest and the game is actively changing everyone's dialogue to reflect that throughout the entire open world.
That's awesome.
Because they can't acknowledge certain things and they can't spoil certain things and stuff like that. So like they just have different dialogue when I get to them and it's all
different.
That's
awesome. That's proper attention to detail right there.
Like the first thing I did was go to the desert and meet Cass, who you're supposed to meet at like a bird village later on, and he tells you his entire even in these disparate locations, he'll like still tell you the stuff that he's supposed to tell you when you reach him at the designated location, and they just reshuffle the dialogue around and they just make it work. But that's like the Nintendo polish, I guess. And Mass Effect does not currently have Nintendo polish.
There's a lot of polish that it needs, I guess.
Didn't last month they sell Nintendo sold more copies of Breath of the Wild than they sold Switches?
Yeah, yep. They did.
Specifically, they sold more copies of Breath of the Wild for the Switch than Switches.
Right. Yeah, otherwise it wouldn't be noteworthy because of the Wii U version.
Yes.
Oh, true. That makes
makes sense.
Wow, that's awesome.
So I listened to some of the justifications, and part of it is there were a number of. There were a number of people that were buying it because there were promotions to get like Breath of the Wild for 20% off, specifically on like Amazon and stuff like that. So it made it a little bit easier for them to, justify like, hey, I want to pick this up.
And I wonder if maybe some people couldn't get their Switch, but they were like, but I'll grab Zelda and all the amiibos for later.
Because if you guys have been following it at all, there have been supply issues, as always. Whenever Nintendo puts out a new platform, it always has supply issues, whereas Breath of the Wild, they did not have the issue.
Because it's just a disc.
Yeah. Yep.
And people can buy it online. I wonder if the figure includes that.
Speaking of, did you hear what Nintendo did with the NES Classic? They discontinued it.
Really?
Yeah, man, that sucks so much.
Why?
Wasn't the story there that they made the Classic and then it was so short on supply that nobody could ever really get a hold of it, and then they just canceled it before anyone really could get it?
Yeah, everyone wanted it. Like, everyone was like, come on, make more. And then they were like, okay, we're discontinuing this entirely. It doesn't. It sucks. I hope that they cancel it, because I want in 3 months for them to release like the Nintendo Omni that like has the virtual console and just like bundles up everything.
So I did read one comment that was saying that the article is misinterpreting it and saying that they were just the reality was they're just stopping the production for the season until the next one or something. But I didn't follow up on that to see if there was more.
I didn't follow up on that either.
Game journalism is often so wrong that it might actually be inaccurate.
Well, it used to be worse, though. If there's one thing I feel that game journalism is... I think it's been better lately. Well, it depends on the outlets, I suppose.
I've never followed it before, never followed it now, so I don't know.
Yeah. I think it was back around 2006, 2007. I was really into... I wanted to be a game journalist. Even my university, I studied archaeology. But I wanted to get into journalism, and then I changed because I thought archaeology would be better, which turned out it wasn't. big surprise. But I was really involved for a long while in game journalism, and I remember it being really problematic back in, I think, 2007. There was even, like, GameSpot were firing guys that they were doing. There was one guy that did a bad review of I don't remember. I think it was Tomb Raider or something. And because... the company had paid GameSpot or something for some reason. They fired a guy or whatever. It's just big bad
stuff. That's kind
of
a common story.
Are we talking about Jeff Gerstmann?
Probably.
I think so. That sounds familiar.
Firing
yeah.
him for his review of Kanan Lynch.
Kanan Lynch.
Oh,
that's
what it was.
Yeah, that's what gave birth to Giant Bomb. Is everyone left GameStop when that happened and made Giant Bomb, which is like the best mm-hmm. game website, and they have like the best gaming podcast.
I would say so.
Yeah, there's. I think these days it's better than it used to be. Also because mm-hmm. I think YouTubers also removed a little bit of the need for game journalism just to expose games, because we're here just to have fun with the games and show the games. So game journalism can dedicate itself to just critics and a sort of analysis.
Now, I mean, there's still like tons of controversies over like people fixing scores and stuff like that. I don't remember what the site was, but there's a site. It's kind of one of the smaller like just text based review sites, but they've been having a lot of issues lately because the main guy that owns the site. He will, change scores and like switch reviews around so they sound more positive to go in line with the, money being thrown at them and stuff like that. But what he will do is if the person pisses him off or leaves the company, he will wipe all accreditation to the person. So if Keith starts writing a bunch of, reviews from this guy or like for this site, this guy and, eventually Keith quits, this guy will put his name over where Keith's was saying like, I wrote this.
This was
review.
Mine. Yeah.
I used to fancy myself a little bit of a games journalist, and I was like writing reviews and stuff for a website called Tech Goblin.
Oh, yeah, you used to do that.
That was like the early days where, like, I basically before Sad Games, even like before doing Let's Plays, I was just like, I'm going to write reviews of things and write about news. And
I'm picturing my review being like, I really, really liked this game. This game was a lot of fun, it had levels.
That's the worst part, is doing reviews, because from the start that you can't fall on that. And one of the things that I actually did reviews as well, I mean, in Portuguese though, but I did reviews for a small website that we had here as well. The first thing I learned is that you can't focus too much on what, subjective stuff. So you need to focus on what the game does and what you feel it could do. But at the end of the day, at the end of the review, if you don't say outright if you like the game or not, it just people get out of the review like, okay.
Yeah, they're not going to know.
Yeah. it's a tricky balance, I feel, anyway.
I've just
Keith, a critic did you give everything? Yeah.
It's really
being a critic gets you shit on.
Yeah.
who got it right, though, from the beginning? Yahtzee? What's his name? I know it's Yahtzee. The guy
Ben Crenshaw. Yeah. Yahtzee.
Zero punctuation is pretty dang good. Yeah.
Yeah.
And I've been watching him a lot again lately.
Just sound universally angry and people will just become numb to it, like South Park.
That's true. You can't tell. Even like, he's like, I really like Portal 2. Portal 2 is really good. I have a lot of fun when I play Portal 2. It's like, do you like Portal 2, or what is this?
I can't tell.
You do a good Yahtzee. That sounded close to him.
That's good. My impersonations are either 100 or they're goofy.
I feel like
or
you
they're
use
somewhere
the same
in the
voice to say I do not like green eggs and ham.
Yeah. Anyway, yeah.
Oh boy.
So that. Suddenly nobody knows what to say to that.
Okay, well,
I read out some green eggs and ham?
I have like a really weird gripe to have with
what?
Do you guys want to talk about Mass Effect anymore? Because
not really.
Boy.
I'm kind of done.
Boy,
yeah.
Boy,
it's like you want to talk about Suicide Squad some more, Keith. Like,
I just gotta point out just one thing real quick, which is that game tells you about a cloister of sequestered monks that where their entire point is isolationism and separateness and so on, so they can maintain their internal stories and so on, right? The moment you get there, you call down a fucking forward station from orbit. And it just camps in the middle of their cloister, and it's there forever now. And
then they hand you side quests,
and you get weapons out of it because it's a fucking armory. And you call that down like in Mass Effect, you are the bad guys. You are the invading alien force from every movie ever. You colonize other people's planets they're already living on and fill them with weapons and act like they're the bad guys. There's a whole planet where you're just killing the people that live there already. And they're not even, like, they weren't attacking you at the Nexus. You were just, like, attacking them on their home planet.
Mm-hmm.
And then, like, and then you're like, well, these guys are racist. It's like, you're on their home killing them.
Yeah, it's no wonder, though, right? But you're the Pathfinder, though, so that justifies it all.
Everything's okay.
That's enough Mass Effect for now. So I got
you're
a question.
The chosen
that,
one.
I got
the
a question
prophecy.
To read because it baffled me.
Yep.
Uh-huh. Diego Santos asks, do you imagine yourself still playing video games, I assume, is what they meant to say, in 70 years or more?
Oh, Jesus, that's a long time from now.
I expect to be dead.
110 years old, still playing video games. Of course you will, right? At that age, what else?
I will be 97 years old in 70 years. So I expect to be quite dead. Or we're living in a utopian society where I am still 20. I revert to being 20, in which case, sure.
But I would like there to be a...
The answer is either I'm dead or yes, I guess is really the that's basically
Keith
it.
Keith is going to be a digitized personality that exists purely to play video games.
Can I be Xerxes from System Shock?
Was he the good one or the evil one?
Place?
No, it was the bad one.
I'll have a face made out of binary.
No, Shodan was the bad one. Xerxes was the one that was just like,
Xerxes
I would
was
like
even,
to fly the ship.
I don't think like Xerxes was even self-aware, to be honest. I think it was just an AI.
Didn't Xerxes just like fucking make sure the vending machines didn't run out of soda and stuff like that?
I'm helpful.
Yeah, and then Shodan like overtook his mind and became like evil Xerxes.
Like, and like always, you can send questions into fournerdsquestions@gmail.com. There's an unusually early
Thanks
reminder.
Thanks for the ones in the podcast, everybody.
I think I sent you a question once, but it was really it was really philosophical and political, and I knew it was. It was the worst question.
Let's see if I can find it.
I sent it from my email, so you might find it. Just to touch on the on playing video games at an old age, I think if you look at my society, as it were, can be a little bit different, I guess. But you know, old people these days here probably play like Sudoku and even just sort of
puzzle
games.
All the old people
games.
Are playing Flappy Bird now and like Farmville and Facebook games.
Yeah. But the sort of games that keeps the brain working and just sort of puzzle games, as it were. And I think that part of games is always going to be there. Who knows what gaming is going to be like in 70 years, if there's even going to be gaming, because
I'm going to get a little heavy here, but in 70 years, like, medical technology is going to be so, so advanced that, like, even though we say, like, I'll be dead in 70 years, that
maybe
might
not
be true.
Yeah,
Like, we could see people that live to be, like, 150 or 170 years old within our lifetimes, assuming we live that long, I guess. But I kind of screwed up that thought. The point is, like, the first person who's going to live to be 150 is probably alive today, for example.
And not us.
If you... maybe. But, like, if you can stay alive long enough, like, medical technology can just keep you going and going and going. And then, like, who the fuck knows how long
people
are going to
get
be living
there is be
soon.
The villain of every story.
That's true.
It's
I cannot find this email if it exists.
I will inject myself with
like
the blood of pre-teenage heroes who will...
Or maybe I dreamt it. But I think the only thing
empire.
The only thing that you need to look at is, for example, like my grandmother is 84, I think. My granddad from my father's side died at 93. And when he was born, the average expectancy was like 60. So that's 50% more. Because the life expectancy is not when you are born. Like, ours is probably, 70, 80 when we were born. But as time moves on, if nothing terrible happens.
But it's also probably kind of an average, right?
Yeah, it's always an average. Yeah.
And it reflects like childhood birth, surviving through birth and stuff
you
like that.
You basically just need to go around and kill some 20-year-olds to boost your stats.
Yeah. No, actually not.
You would get EXP.
That's what they mean by experience.
Ones.
How weird would that be if you, like, punched a duck and you gave him 1 EXP and it, like, popped up very clear as day?
And, like, it probably out-level him
or something?
You probably like, out-level him in no time.
I've punched this duck and now I know math better.
This is a matrix.
If you put my point into intelligence.
If you could kill people to get their time, you'd basically just end up with that Justin Timberlake movie called In Time that was terrible.
Justin Timberlake was in a movie about killing people? That seems really
weird. It was a movie where everyone had a wrist thing where they could tell how long they had to live, and money was time. So like time to live was your salary and stuff like that.
I have never seen any movie with this man. That
like,
I just Googled.
Like rich people were like just immortal, basically, and all the poor people died young, and it was like, it's an allegory for life.
I'm surprised you never heard Justin Timberlake. He was the ex-president of Portugal.
The ex-president. He was elected the ex-president.
Yeah, he was elected as ex-president initially.
He was elected and immediately lost the election.
He was elected and impeached in the exact same vote.
Yes.
It is my honor to have served you.
To have served, yeah, to have been the president.
Son, one day you'll make a great ex-president.
And that There's person grew up to be Bill Clinton.
Is he a great ex-president? I don't know. I don't follow.
Oh. All you have to do to be a good ex-president is just say good things when you don't need to actually be in control of stuff anymore.
To be a good ex-president, you just have to, like, donate a bunch of money to Africa. That's what Jimmy Carter did. It's what George W. Bush did. And...
Jimmy Carter's done a hell of a lot more. Jimmy Carter's done more as an ex-president than he has done, or than he did as a president, which is...
Jimmy Carter's done a lot of good.
Yeah.
I'm very impressed with what Jimmy Carter gets the birdcatcher stamp of approval for his post-presidency works.
Yes,
well,
I'm
sure
he's very
thinking,
proud.
Like, as I was saying that, I was like, this is the... Like, this doesn't mean anything for me to say, like, you're doing a good job,
Jimmy Carter. You know who needs a lot of praise and approval? Presidents.
Bird, you should draw, like, a really shitty, like, amulet-looking thing. And, like, send it to him after cutting it.
It's just an off-brand Nintendo seal of approval and, like, Sharpie. It's all crooked.
Just a picture of me giving a thumbs up with, like, a big old crookedy smile.
And you draw it on a post-it and just add, a pin it to it. And just, you can wear it on your shirt, whatever. I'm sure you'd wear it, yeah.
All right. So that was a weird tangent.
Where did we start?
We had other things we were going to talk about.
Do you guys
want to
talk about the sexy Brutale?
That's what I was going to bring up, yes.
Gotta be Brutale, right? But I'm not never entirely sure.
It's Brutale. Probably Brutale.
You almost certainly don't
Italian.
Pronounce the E,
they say Brutale,
but it's a weird
don't they?
Word.
Italians would say Brutale, but...
Yeah.
I just figure, like, Royale.
Yeah.
Well, I guess it would be Brutale.
It's a Brutale with cheese.
Delicious.
Oh, yeah, you're right. I think so, yeah.
Yeah, Wander, tell us about Sexy Brutale.
That game's real good.
I have differing opinions.
Well, those...
Are we ready for this?
Okay.
Oh,
so,
no.
So my problem is I beat this game in 2 nights. So
did
I did the first 4 in the first night, and then the remaining 3, it gets a little bit muddy. The second night, over the course of, I want to say 6 or 7 hours. Like, it's not actually that long. And it's actually super, super fun. I mean, the entire premise is it's kind of like this supernatural murder mystery where, like, you're at this casino and all the partygoers are kind of like old friends of the person that owns the casino, and they're getting murdered. Repeatedly and
well, not repeatedly.
Oh no, I've been murdered repeatedly.
Well,
the second time tonight.
Yeah. It's like if you took Bill Murray?
It's like Clue crossed with Groundhog Day. Yeah,
and then evil magic and shit. And it's like
so every guest gets murdered over the course of 24 hours, but then every time the day ends, your magic watch kind of like resets the day over and over again.
Oh,
yeah.
That sounds cool.
You're trying to find
really
out.
Cool.
The cool gimmick it has is that you can't be in the same room as any of the people.
Yeah, no one can see you.
Yeah.
You have to do... So you have to, like, peer in through locks and, like, one-way mirrors and stuff
like
that.
You basically have to spy on people. It's like... It's like the core. It's like as if the whole like everyone has a schedule thing from Elder Scrolls games that they championed so hard actually had a point in that it was the core gameplay mechanic, because everybody has a very specific routine they do over the course of the day, all the way up to leading to the events of their death, and so you have to spy on them all day to figure out what's going to happen and what stuff leads to them. So like. Like in the tutorial mission, you'll see a guy running down the hallway and he seems panicked and you'll follow him for a bit. And then you eventually see how he dies and you're like, wait, what would I do about that? And you like see the other character involved in that scene. You're like, okay, now I got to find out where they were early in the day and follow them all day and see how these two paths intersect and stuff like that.
God, that sounds so cool.
There's so many intersecting paths.
It is really cool.
Characters going all over the place, and realizing the whole game takes place over one loop means you can see stuff early on that doesn't come up until like 4 hours later.
Yeah, the, like, lights will flicker, and you're like, why does the lights flicker? And, like, two murders later, you're like, oh, that's why they flicker.
Yeah, like, like one of the first scenes of the game features a gunshot, and then for the rest of the game, at that time of day, you always hear a gunshot for the rest of the game, but you've always hearing, like, things like lights flicker, and you hear a crash of glass, and you hear a bunch of other different sounds and sights, and you're like, those all probably are someone's death, but where and when? It's a real neat concept, just from front to back.
So,
What's your problem with it?
We can get into it in a bit. Let's talk the positives. Mainly, we're actually going to have to hold off on the main reasons why I dislike the game until next week, because Keith hasn't beaten the game, and I assume since none of you guys are playing it. The reason why I dislike the game is at the very end, and I
is
don't want to get into that.
Is it a mechanical or story thing?
Both.
I guess the mechanics are the story in a way in this game.
Exactly. They tie it together really well, which is why I have this problem. But you'll honestly probably see exactly what I mean, and we'll get to that in a bit. So anyway, I really actually do appreciate the game. The like core concept of like stalking people over the course of a day and like figuring out, okay, like who done it and how. And I mean, to be fair, it's not really much of a murder mystery because it's super obvious who's killing them all the time.
It was Bird.
The mystery is how to prevent the murder each time.
Yeah, so
it's the puzzle, yeah.
Yeah, the hotel staff or the casino staff are all wearing like these gas masks, and like they're immediately just super creepy.
The art style and the soundtrack. Yeah.
Oh yeah, the art style is amazing. The soundtrack is amazing. The gameplay itself is pretty good. I wish there were a couple of mechanics to make things go a little bit better. Like I specifically insist upon seeing every character die because, you know, you could easily solve their murder and just walk off and you never even know how they died or like what happened to them. Yeah. But the problem is, one of my main problems, and I can't talk about this, is everybody dies pretty much around 9 or 10 at night, with a couple of exceptions. Like, most of the groups...
You have the whole day to follow them and solve the puzzle.
And for the most part, you actually need the whole day. And so, originally, we were thinking, oh, you'd actually have to save everybody all in one day.
Yeah.
But it's impossible to do that, and it becomes super obvious when, like, some of the things require you to actively tail a character, and you're just like, oh, that's kind of annoying, because I really wanted to, like, I really wanted to figure out everybody's schedules and, like, sprint around this mansion and do everything in sequence.
And prevent every death in one run.
Now,
yeah.
Yeah.
I have a question.
Yes.
This play takes place in a casino?
Yes.
It's like a mansion.
So, let's say what I wanted to do... so you have this time power, right?
Yes.
I guess it's almost like a casino cabaret club or something. Like, it's a huge, sprawling place, but there's just, like, different rooms for entertainment.
What I wanted to do was go through the entire casino, take down notes of when people were winning the slot machines, and just... like go through the entire day just winning at slots over and over and over again and say fuck you to solving the mystery and just walk out with every dollar that place has.
The character you're playing as is a priest. And this isn't really spoilers, but you get a character bio later on that tells you that he used to own a casino himself, so it's like why. Like, he gave that life up.
Also,
I thought that was actually
really
neat. There
also isn't much, by the way, of slot machines I've seen so far.
Like, yeah,
mainly,
no,
you see weird you see a couple things that are literally like a single rotating thing for the entire slot machine, which I don't think are even meant for money, but some other mechanic.
That's part of one of the murder puzzles.
Yeah, and then elsewhere you see a guy playing cards.
Yes.
Which is very roulette or something.
That is like,
and that's
literally
different.
They have a Grim Reaper blackjack dealer, which is actually super classy.
Like you do.
Yeah. But
one of the really cool expressions of the routine part of the game is that every time you ever see any player, period, or character, on the map, like just with your own eyes, it basically records their presence. And then when you go on the map, you can scrub forward and backwards in time, and you'll see literally everybody you've ever seen at those moments of time moving around the map, and they'll disappear entirely from the map at any moment you weren't exactly looking at them and stuff like that, and then reappear when you saw them later. So, like, you'll see them just, like, skip a room because you saw them one room later but missed the middle part, and, like, you can see how complete your current mental picture is of everyone's routines so far. Like, it's a really cool detail there.
Adding on to that, at the very end of the game, you get the power to know where everybody is at the same time. Again, not much for spoilers, but it's really cool watching everybody move around.
Doesn't that spoil the puzzle?
Well, but this is after you've solved all the other puzzles.
Oh, okay.
So,
yeah. So it's like they're giving it to you for that puzzle then. Because one of the gimmicks of the game is that everyone has magic masks on, basically. Like, it's a big masquerade, and one effect of the magic mask is that even though you're invisible and no one can see you, if you enter a room with another character in it, their mask will literally come off and start levitating at you to attack you.
Yeah, like, well, time is frozen. It's like this kind of weird
ghostly...
So
you're not supposed to be in the room with any of the masks. But also, if you rescue anybody from their deaths, then they take their mask off, and you get to take their mask and incorporate their power, which is some ability that they themselves likely had while they were walking around and everything.
Yeah,
and
it's usually a facet of their personality.
Character.
Yeah, so there's like a blind lady with really good hearing, so you get really good hearing for extra spying on people.
Yeah.
Which is super handy, because then you can like get... you can actually, you know, get passcodes and stuff like that, which is neat.
Yeah.
Unfortunately, some degree...
You even get a few moments where you get their mask, and then you can go back to their own path and follow them around and pick up on things that they only they were able to notice back when they were the only one with that mask power.
Yeah. Yeah. I followed her specifically for like the whole day, just being like, so what did she do? And it was like, oh, that was actually really neat. Unfortunately, with the mask powers, this is one of the complaints. They don't really like build off of each other. So like usually you go on to the next... you go on to the next puzzle, and you're not using all of your previous mask powers. You only need, like, one or two. So instead of kind of, like, by the end where you're, like, using all of your newfound skills, it's mostly just, like, follow the guy and listen to him. And it's just like, ah! Like, I was really hoping that it would all kind of, like, build into one, and then it didn't actually do that.
Yeah.
It stays kind of simple throughout, for better or worse. But...
It's one of those games where even if it goes to shit at some point, I'll just be so happy it exists because it just screams originality the moment you like launch it. And you're like, yes,
so,
this game happened.
Like, despite the fact that I had a negative experience by the end, I still think it was an awesome game, and I'd love to see somebody take the idea. Hell, I'd love to see them make a sequel and take
the
it
sexier,
further.
Brutaler.
It shouldn't be too difficult for them if it does well. In a lot of regards, this kind of reminds me of... two games that I played. Have you guys ever played Neighbors from Hell? It's not the same sort of game. It's a very old game, 2004, I think.
It
was a side scroller, but they made a second one because it was so easy to make a new one. And it was sort of it was a little bit like this. It wasn't, you know, the murder mystery or anything.
Did you
didn't have the time
to. From Hell?
No, Neighbors from Hell. Basically,
Neighbors from Hell. Oh,
yeah.
Okay.
There's a 2004 game called Michigan Report from Hell, which I'm pretty sure is like that one game everyone laughs at.
Nah, I don't.
The first Suda 51 game or something.
Oh, yeah.
Neighbors from Hell is a decent review.
It's hilarious. It's another hilarious game. It's not the same sort of game. It has some things, but I feel that Sexy Brutalis could have a sequel with pretty low budget, because if you just reuse the assets, it's mostly just about, you know, the engine is there.
They would have to make new assets. The environment is kind of done with. Like, once you've kind of been through the whole casino, if they reused all of that, It would probably get a little bit boring.
Oh, so like a Bioshock thing where like once you make Infinity, you have to make up a new fantastical theme for the whole place to be in.
Yeah.
Because if you go back to Bioshock, it feels weird.
Yeah.
Or well, back Bioshock 2 is the same thing.
Yeah.
Well, Bioshock 2, yeah.
Part of the main point of the game, though, is like exploration and stuff. Like, I loved the... Whenever I got to like a new murder mystery part, or whatever you want to call it, you know, whenever it was like, here's a new person you have to go save, I would completely ignore the fact that I have to go save them.
Just to check out the place.
Yeah, I would fill in every single... I would
fill in every room and find out what weird tricks you could find and stuff.
Yeah, and read all of the like little descriptions, because they've got proper descriptions for practically like everything, every set piece, which is really neat.
Mm-hmm.
And I really appreciated that, because it's like, hey, you know, let's go look at this statue, and eventually find out like the statue was made by the blind chick, and you're like, oh, really? And you know, it was just kind of repeatedly neat stuff.
Sexy and like Easter egg details. Incredibly rewarding for people to like exploring in video games.
Yes.
Yeah.
Why is it called Sexy Brutale?
That's the name of the building.
Yeah.
Oh. It's a weird name of. I guess it's kind of like Casino Royale, but.
Oh, maybe it probably is like, from there.
The almost universal response I've been seeing in the comments is like this is the worst name to give this game because it will turn away everybody who wants this kind of game because they will probably think it's like a visual novel or some kind of other thing they don't
want. I will say that that's a pretty bad name for a video game.
Yes.
For this
it's
type of
game.
But
it doesn't play well because people don't go past the name.
Yeah.
At least it's going to get exposure because of the name.
No, I'm saying it's probably the opposite because like the type of people that want like a thoughtful puzzle exploration game aren't looking for a game called The Sexy Brutale.
Well, yeah, but then those people maybe they know a little bit already about the game, but from some.
I think Sexy Brutale is going to succeed not because of its own right, but because of YouTubers and stuff like that picking it up. I've noticed a lot more YouTubers picking it up lately and doing content on it. Which is good.
Yeah, there's people trying to signal boost it for sure, because, like, for example, like, Jim Sterling just flat out gave it a 10 out of 10, which I think he just does when he's like, this is an indie thing that everyone needs to look at now.
Yeah, like, despite my disappointments, I would definitely say to anybody, like, absolutely pick the game up, because it was amazing and, you know, very worth taking a look at if you've never, you know, if you're into murder mystery kind of things.
Mm-hmm.
The only thing that really irked me at the beginning, I got over it easily enough, but the fact that it's all real time and that you need... I like a paused experience. I enjoy turn-based games because of that. I can deal with real time, but it really... It's the sort of game that it's as you say, you want to explore and not care about the objective. But if you don't realize that you can just not care about the objective, it's tricky because it's all real time.
Mm-hmm.
So there's a lot of trial and error.
I might have to say that's kind of a you problem, because I think the real time kind of enhanced it because you didn't have time to breathe. You had to rush around, and like if you took too long, somebody would barge into your room and you're like,
And part of it's just an experience of like learning. Because you don't immediately know at first, but over time you learn the fact that you can just let the game fail over and over again while you explore, and it doesn't matter at all.
Yeah, it's part of the game. It's real. It's important that it is real time. Otherwise, it would change the game.
Yeah, but the first time it happens, the music's coming up, and you're like, "Oh my god, we're doomed! I'm what do I do? It's too late. I didn't find the thing."
You think like you're actually going to lose the game?
Yeah, you feel like you're in trouble, but it's just how the game plays.
The visual effect as like the day is running out is awesome. I really, really liked.
What is the universe like crashing into itself and a gigantic moon face?
Yeah, it starts
shaking like,
and it starts raining really hard. And
that's Rain World.
You know, it does have the Rain World effect, and but it's like this kind of creepy red rain. Like it fits the whole like the like kind of weird occult thing really well. At least as far as I'm concerned, I don't know. It's just cool.
That's a neat, weird little game.
I didn't get to that part.
All right. Well, do we have any questions?
Sort of.
Do you have any good questions?
First one. King Char, Lord of All, wants to know what our favorite board games are.
Race for the Galaxy, 100%.
That's a good one.
Race for the Galaxy.
It's amazing. It's really hard to learn, but me and a couple of friends learned it in college, and for whatever reason, I was like totally unbeatable for 3 years. Until they kicked me out of the frat, and I was just like, no, I can't play Race for the Galaxy anymore. I was really sad, because like that game is really solid.
I played a game and was really good at it, and then my friends abandoned me. The end.
Doesn't that happen a lot in board games, though? I mean, if you somebody...
Yeah,
I have a similar story, because like, two of my favorite games are Carcassonne and Resistance, but one of my favorites that I can never play is Twilight Imperium. Which is this...
That's a Warhammer game, isn't it?
...ordeal of a game. I don't think it's Warhammer related, but it's
called Twilight Imperium. How the hell is that not Warhammer related?
It's just something called Twilight Imperium. But Twilight Imperium is basically, like, a civilization-style game done in space with, like, a board game. So as you mentioned, it's like an ordeal. Like, you and your friends are going to sit down and play this game for 8 hours.
Oh my god, this is so complicated.
You have a hex-based galaxy grid with randomized tiles and stuff like that. Everyone has their home worlds around the rim of the around the rim of the galaxy. The middle of the galaxy is like a sort of like cash cow influence planet that everyone kind of wants if they want to have influence over votes and stuff like that. And what happens is everybody gets a personal objective that only they know. It's a face-down card that they read that is a objective they're supposed to try to accomplish. And then basically every round of the game, of which there's only like 8, like it's not a lot, the game is short as far as round count goes, every round a new public objective is revealed, and you're basically racing to get a certain number of victory points basically to win the game, which is a combination of private and public objectives. And the private ones are the really nasty ones because they like to incentivize you to like attack enemy home planets and stuff like that.
Damn, that's cool.
It is a hell of a game. And
it looks really cool.
So hard to get people to play it.
I mean, I'm just looking at the amount of stuff. I did a search. I'm looking at the amount of stuff that players have in front of them. Not even the table. It's just so many cards, so much stuff.
Oh my god. I'm sorry. I'm doing an image search right now, and I found someone made a custom table for Twilight Imperium that's a gargantuan hex-based table with giant custom tiles and physical globes for all the planets.
It looks amazing.
Wow.
Oh my god. I want those friends.
I want those too.
Insane.
Are you saying you want rich friends?
Yes.
With a lot of free time?
Yeah.
So I want a lot of upper class rich friends.
This is so cool looking. Holy shit, they had so much time to put this together.
It's a very neat game, but unfortunately, every time you play it, there's always somebody that's like, oh my god, that was my whole day, and they never come back. And so, like, you're every single game, there's at least one or two people that you're tutorializing for the first time, and you just never can build enough momentum to make it consistent. Yeah. Like, it never quite reached that level of, like, a D&D campaign where you're meeting up every 2 weeks to do this thing for a while.
That's why you do a sleepover the day before for you tutorializing.
Yeah, you don't do sleepovers after, nine.
I did a sleepover. Done a sleepover because of this game.
Oh god!
because we played at the house that I live at now, but I used to live an hour away. So I came here at one point and played for like 8 hours, and then I just slept on their couch and left in the morning because it was just so late. And
there was
worth
a book I read when I was a little kid called Interstellar Pig, which was kind of like a different version of, I don't know, it was a young adult novel. Well, it's not very great, but it was kind of like Ender's Game, sort of, in that like these kids found this board game called Interstellar Pig, and then it turns out like that board game was real life. And it was like a space opera type of board game where you were trying to conquer the galaxy, yada, yada, yada. The point is, in middle school, for extra credit, me and some friends, we made a version of this board game where we literally had, like, it actually kind of looks like this tabletop setup where we had these fake spheres, like these styrofoam balls for planets and things like that. And you could arrange them, and you had, we made cards for them, and we made card art, and we did all of this work for this extra credit thing. And then the teacher was like, that's nice. And we didn't actually get any extra credit for it.
Wow.
Yes. But the person, okay.
Isn't that how it always goes?
So the person who really, really like sunk so much time into this, like he went like nuts making this thing. He worked on it for like a week and a half straight, like every single day outside of homework and stuff. He went on to like go to pre-med and like he gets like this, he like blows away the MCAT. He like is like lined up to go so far in life. And then he burns out and he decides, screw it. I'm not going to go to medical school. And he like drops out of like college to become, a TA.
Damn, well, Bird.
What is a TA?
Teaching assistant.
Oh.
Yeah.
Mm.
So like,
isn't that
going to
burn him out even more?
Yeah. So he works with his mom at a high school, like organizing the library. Yeah. And this is like one of the smartest people I've ever met in my life and like so hardworking. And he just like snaps as soon, like he like reaches like the mountaintop of his life and then just like throws it out.
Damn.
Wow. I haven't thought about that guy in a very long time. But yeah, that's, I wonder what he's up to. I wonder if he's still, like, doing that.
Well, if he's smart, I guess the doors will always be there, I guess. But, you know, career is a difficult thing, but I guess.
No. Yeah. I mean.
So, Bird's favorite board game is the game of life.
Yeah. I don't know what my favorite board game is. I like, I can't remember the name of any board games off the top of my head all of a sudden.
Carcassonne?
No, not
Catan.
Carcassonne. I like Stratego. Stratego is really fun. It's like Stratego is like chess, but like more complicated.
I tried playing Stratego, but the only person that I could play with was my dad, and he kicked my ass so hard I never played it again.
Oh yeah, I never learned how that game works.
Yeah, it's really fun. It's like pretty simple.
It's like flag checkers.
It's sort of like chess or checkers, where like it's really. Like, the depth of it is astounding, and you can get, like, life-dedicatingly good at Stratego.
But at what cost?
Yes!
I'm a professional Stratego player. My ELO is 3,004. There's
Actually,
only three
Go
other people
here?
I can play Stratego with. What? You play Go? It was
no,
cool.
Just you become the problem with over-specializing in board games is then you just end up surrounded by people that only play other board games.
That's true, yeah.
I'm surrounded by people
that
don't play board games. That's
my
problem.
Just to scare people more about Twilight Imperium, on top of that visual you guys saw, that game has tech trees.
I'm sure it does.
You just need to see a picture and you know that game is amazing.
Board games basically became super inspired by video games, and like they just become like really slow video games that you spend like $130 on.
we're in the middle of a huge boom for board games because of Kickstarter.
Yeah,
Kickstarter
there's so many
is
cool
the
ones.
Best part. I mean, board games are like the best type of Kickstarter practically because
they actually get finished.
Well, yeah, because every Kickstarter product ever pretty much is either a video game or like, well, we promise we'll try to make this, we'll see what happens. And then other things like is a bunch of stuff where like somebody has an idea for a product, but they have to do like all of the R&D still and creation of it and all that other nightmare stuff. You can create an entire board game and test it for years for free.
Yes. Yep.
Because it's just paper. Because
you just make it out of pieces of paper.
Yeah. And then you just have, then it's like, we need a Kickstarter for this game so we can like, I don't know, make art assets and then publish it.
Yeah, that's why every Kickstarter for a board game gets finished in like 3 months.
Yeah.
It's just, they're done.
Like, we already have the game. Here's the rules. We just want to kickstart like a published version, basically.
Yep.
And then that's what happens.
Chat says, I like Ticket to Ride. Ticket
to
Ride
is
really, really good.
Like, he just backs like dozens of board game Kickstarters. So we just have this gargantuan shelf of them.
And then you get like the alphas. Yeah, they send you like so the pre-release many. Versions.
So I went to a convention for like pre, you know, kind of like Kickstarter-y board games and stuff. It was not pretty, actually. For every like board game that succeeds on Kickstarter, there's like hundreds that don't make the cut. And
yeah,
it was super painful to go there because there's like two board games that you knew like were going to make the cut and one already had. Yeah. And then all the other ones were just like, yeah, so we're going to be putting this on Kickstarter mainly because we like need an artist and they're like their stuff is all like really shitty hand drawn and they've got like note cards and everything all over the place and it's just like,
ooh,
just hire the artist to begin with and hopefully you can recoup the losses from the Kickstarter because man, actually, I got an email a while back from a developer. I don't know if I posted this in Discord or anything like that, but he's like, he was asking for investors, more or less. So that
I heard, you know, all YouTubers were really rich.
Yeah, so he was trying to reach out and get YouTubers to both throw money at him and also tout his like Indiegogo or whatever to, you know, try and pull in some extra people. It was not
desperate.
Not pretty. Yeah, it was very desperate looking. And I was just like, I'm just going to hide this.
Are there any pornographic board games? Are there any adults-only board games?
I mean, what's your standard for adults-only? That got more vague. Because, like,
yes.
Like, at some point, like, Exploding Kittens, I think, has an adults-only version where it's like, now the Exploding Kittens are on people's penises or whatever the hell. And, like, what is it? Like, Cards
Kittens
Against Humanity is not for children.
About?
It's not? Oh, it's not. Yeah.
Oh.
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, one of the cards is two midgets shitting in a bucket.
Yes.
That's the name of
the
card.
I don't know that card in particular, but yeah, it's true. It's true.
That's just what Cards Against Humanity is. Like, that's adults only. Pornographic would at least be more nuanced than that, but I don't know a pornographic game, but I guaranteed they exist.
All right,
it's
going to
be really
Google
weird to play,
this.
Though. Right?
Pornographic board games. Oh!
It sounds like Bird found
There's
something.
Some rough search result images, but also I got Candyland for some reason.
Well,
is it candy with an eye land?
No, it's just Candyland with the old guy going, like, huh, thumbs up, and little kids and everything. Like, there's nothing
to do. Oh, Jesus, yeah, you're right. There
it
is.
It's just straight up Candyland.
This one's called Booby Trap. This one's called...
Probably done with that topic.
Bumps and Grinds. Oh, there we go. That sounds like a hot board game
the
right
idea.
There. You guys keep talking. I'm gonna research this.
You guys keep talking. I'm gonna do some research. should we do another question or something?
3.5 out of 10 on Board Game Geek. People
Benjamin
aren't
Meyer
big
asks,
fans of Bumps and Grinds.
What are your guys' biggest pet peeves in video games and why?
Oh, that's a good question.
Oh
boy.
Save points. I hate games with save points slash checkpoints that are few and far between. If you have to like go back through an entire level to like get to the boss or like wherever you died, it's just like really.
Yeah.
Especially like kind of modern games that have like a.
Speaking of which, we'll be playing Dark Souls later tonight.
Yeah, well, so, like, Dark Souls has definitely gotten better. Like, Dark Souls 1, I would say, is probably the biggest offender.
Mm-hmm.
The Undead Settlement and the Duke's Archives.
Yeah, well, yeah, Duke's Archives is actually really short if you don't bother exploring. Bird and I went through that, and it was, like, comical.
Yeah, but don't you have to replay all the way from the Archives through the Crystal Cave all the way down to Seath every time you fight him?
No, there's a bonfire
there's a bonfire
the Seath staircase.
Oh. Mm-hmm. I don't
Do
remember that game
that?
As well. Maybe I didn't.
Okay.
I don't know. Maybe that was my life.
I would say it was really hidden, but it was actually like super obvious. But you wouldn't think to like look there. So I don't know.
Just touching on that. I'm really bad at. I really fall into save scumming. So I like when a game's forced me to just have checkpoints. Some of my. Like, my favorite first-person shooter of all time is Far Cry, the original one. And it didn't have quick saves. It was a checkpoint system. And I enjoyed it because of that. And there's a lot of roguelikes. We mentioned before, Neo Scavenger is another one like that, where you can save, but if you die, you die. It's a permadeath situation.
Roguelikes are kind of a different monster entirely.
It's different. Mm. Yeah, yeah. But I don't know what you mean. I just wanted to...
Yeah, yep. System Shock 2 really raises the question between, like, save spots versus manual saving, because, like, it has the Bioshock system of there being, like, resurrection chambers in every level, and yet you can also manually save and load, like, instantly anywhere you want.
Yeah.
So it's so you start questioning which one of these is actually the intended system for playing the game, because they're both there, and
yeah,
you're not sure what they mean.
Yeah, it's very confusing. It's very confusing.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know. I don't think that there's some, like, one thing I can point to in general that annoys me in video games. Like, because there's something that really, like,
Invaders.
Unskippable cutscenes? That's mine.
Oh, yeah. Actually, back to my pet peeve. Save points right before unskippable cutscenes is the worst. Especially when the cutscenes are long. I was playing, Digimon Cyber Sleuth a while back. That was you know, mostly good fun. But the there was one time where a bunch of people were like, you need to play on hard mode because, like, easy mode's too easy and, like, you're getting the watered down experience. So I'm like, all right, screw it, let's try it. And I was actually doing fairly well up until I hit the boss who just one-shot my entire team.
Yeah.
And then I had to sit through. I imagine if, like, you had...
You'll never save the digital world.
Imagine if you had, like, Danny Sexbang as, like, a hair metal band guy that was, like, the most annoying person in the universe. And he was, like, he would talk for, like, 10-15 minutes straight.
Oh, goody.
Yeah, that was
beautiful.
Yeah, we had a recent experience in Sonic Unleashed where... you would land on a hex-shaped platform, which is always like, oh, a big disc, time to fight, guys. So a bunch of cutscene plays, then a bunch of enemies spawn in, and you fight them all. Then immediately you have to do a really awkward platforming section that's really iffy and has a bad camera and everything like that. So immediately we fall off a cliff and die. And lo and behold, the checkpoint was before that whole fighting part we did before the platforming section. So every time you mess up the platforming, you have to redo the fighting part.
Right.
But
right.
I've had fixed save points kill a game for me. Years ago, I tried to play Persona 4 for the first time, and the game, like, I was lured in by the game's, like, hours and hours of story, because it's, like, a visual novel for a very long time, and I was like, oh, I'm into this, let's see what happens. And then you even do, like, scripted boss fights, where you, like, you just get plopped directly into a combat scenario, fight it, and then go on with the story. But eventually the game finally starts being a regular video game, hours and hours in, it seemed like, where you go through an actual dungeon from front to back, and the game doesn't really explain the dungeons very well. So when I got into a dungeon, I'm like, okay, I'll fight through a few floors, and then after a few floors, you get a mini-boss for the first time ever in an actual dungeon. And he just starts one-shotting everybody, and I'm like, what's going on?
Yeah, and, like, so... Persona games are, like, secret grindy games, so, like, you think normally you just play through the level and you fight the boss, but really what you're supposed to do is grind through, stop for the night, come back, grind through again, like, two or three more times, then you find the find and fight the boss.
But the game doesn't really contextualize that very well.
Jeez.
The game doesn't really contextualize that fact. Like, it's built into the game that, like, you have, like, 2 weeks to save the person, so every day you go into the dungeon is one day in real life, so you have, like, tons of time. But naturally, you would expect to, like, hit a natural stopping point for you to leave and then come back. But the game just stomps
you. Reach the end.
And your punishment is that the game has fixed save points, like, back at your house or something like that, I think, or something like that. At least they weren't inside the dungeon. So if you spent an hour fighting your way through the dungeon up to that mini-boss and get stomped, you lose all of that with no warning. And... Me being, like, the person that thinks it's like every other video game, I'm like, okay, I'll just try again, but, like, maybe try a different strategy. And, like, nope, get stomped, start the entire dungeon over again. And I'm like, after, like, the third time, I'm like, I don't know if I want to play this whole chunk again that I keep losing my progress on. And so I never made it further than that in Persona, because I just didn't feel like it, even though it's supposed to be a great game. And it's one of those things, like, it would have been better if the game just had some better explanation of how that even works, because I can work around how a game works, but I just didn't know, and it was a problem exacerbated by the fact that it has, as we talked about, no save points, because you have to save at a specific location, which is something that's thankfully taken away in Tokyo Mirage Sessions, a game I hate from the same people. But the one thing it did do right is you could, at any point that wasn't like a cutscene or a boss fight... Like, if you're just walking around in any context in the real world or the fake world, you just pause, hit save, the end. And you have, like, 20 save slots, and you can save anywhere. It's great. Every game should have that, especially JRPGs. Yep.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And Japanese games in general. It's one of the big reasons why I could never get into Silent Hill is because you just have specific safe spots and it's... I don't know.
I can kind of get behind that in a horror game because it's all about tension. Yeah, like even Resident Evil 7 tension, still did that. And although it would weirdly sometimes compromise it by making weird invisible save points here and there right before boss fights. Like the thing of like, oh, I've got to, like the idea of like having a save point in the mansion, like this is my safe room where all my stuff is. And like, we're going to go on an expedition to find loot and fight enemies and try to get through alive so you can make a return trip and be like, I made it. I keep that progress. Yeah. It's kind of like a cool part of the genre that can be lost otherwise. Yeah. And almost like a weird roguelite element in a way.
I always felt
people hate when you say that.
Yeah, but because it's not exactly to what it means. But I personally like the way Resident Evil does it. I don't know what the difference is though. I think Resident Evil is more, as you say, centralized in certain spots where you just go out and explore a little bit. For Silent Hill, it's more expedition based, where you just have specific spots every once in a while. I don't know.
Yeah, because in Silent Hill, more of a progression through a linear area, more or less, as opposed to like. So Resident Evil has its roots in being in a singular mansion that you're opening doors of over time.
Yeah, yeah. It's more contained, I guess, Resident Evil is. And also the zombies don't respawn, if I remember correctly.
Oh, do enemies respawn in Silent Hill after you kill them?
In the first
one, that's actually a huge pet peeve I have of older games, is respawning enemies. It's such bullshit, man. Especially if it's one of those old like NES games.
Side-scrollers, so they respawn off-camera.
Yeah, or like the gameplay is like you pick up something and throw it at an enemy, and like that's how you kill them because it's like a really
the thing
really
you
bad
throw
game.
Doesn't come back.
The thing you throw doesn't come back, but the enemies do, and you're like, what the fuck? How do I do anything?
The go-to example of like that going to shit was in the original Ninja Gaiden has this one jump where in order to make the jump you have to somehow deal with the fact that there's an enemy in the jump arc. But you can literally attack him and then mid-jump have him respawn because of how the camera works. And he'll still be there to attack you. And like you literally, I just killed this guy. And in the middle of the jump I'm killing him for, he's coming back because the camera slightly went past his spawn point. It's like a nightmare.
Oh boy.
That's right. I remember that from a speedrun. I think I saw that happen to somebody. And he's like, no. Oh.
It's like a super specific, like infamously like nightmare moment in a level because it's just not, it can't be working as intended.
Yeah, well,
it's just a nightmare.
It is. They just didn't give a shit back then.
people cared less about making games back then. Like there was a period of time where you would just finish the project and it was such a short project in many cases that it was just kind of what it was. Like people didn't even know what the right way to do stuff was in many cases, and so they would just put stuff in places like somebody
there was
playing
no right
with the
time.
Level generator.
Yeah, well, I mean, it's like if you really think about how like the levels are structured in a lot of old games, it like makes no fucking sense, especially if they're platformers.
I think it's part of why Mario stood out so much early on is there was such a horrifying amount of thought put into their level design all the time.
Yeah, even like in the they had like really cohesive things that are like really kind of primitive and taken as obvious to us now.
Yeah,
but like things like they had like you know, the very first screen, for example, is totally taught to teach you that touching the mushroom is good and touching the Goomba is bad, and like it's so well done that nobody realizes that they put a huge amount of thought and design into that specific moment
specifically because nobody had done it before, and just they have to come up with that sort of stuff.
Right. You had to tutorialize through play because putting text everywhere would just make like it would actually have trouble fitting on the disc.
On the disc, yeah.
That's why Wasteland 1, like whenever you got to story stuff, it'd be like, now refer to the manual to find out what this guy's saying in the story because we can't fit it in the game.
You're right. They did do that back in the day.
There was an era in video games where text was too much data.
you had to flip to a manual to read the story.
Can you imagine a BioWare game existing in that era?
Planescape Torment just ships with a goddamn like book that's like 3 inches thick.
I'm just imagining a BioWare game being a choose your own adventure book, like novel sized one that also just comes with a video game as a screensaver.
As a screensaver, right?
So you'd spend so little time looking at the screen at that point because of all the text you have to read in your book.
That wasn't the biggest problem though. Back in back in the day, there were even, I mean, I'm talking the 80s. I wasn't alive at the time, but like 70s, not so much 70s, but 80s, they had copy protection in the books.
Oh, and, yes.
And then everybody just figured out just copy, photocopied or Xerox the books. And then they made like special lenses that you had to look through.
Yes.
Yeah. Yep. I think Might and Magic had this.
DRM's not new.
I had a, what was it, DuckTales? Like, this really old, like, Disney game where what you had to do was open up the manual and then pull out, like, this decoder thing that was, like, this really dark red sheet of paper, and you'd, like, put it over the manual, and it would, like, highlight certain words, and then you'd type that code in, and then the game would let you continue.
Oh, but that one is easy.
That one was easy.
I know of one that you need to put it over the TV, but I don't know which game it is. But it's like a decoder. You put it over the TV, and because
and it
of the way
it doesn't even work on like new TVs,
it doesn't
TVs
even work
too.
Exactly. the problem is DRM old now. TVs. Yeah, it doesn't. It only works with CRT and all this sort of stuff. It's just
yeah.
What was the latest that kind of thing happened? Was it like Metal Gear 1? Like in order to continue the story, look up Meryl's codec number in the manual.
As a kid, I never questioned that. Well, I thought it was weird. I thought it was weird that you had to like pull open the manual. But I was just like, whatever, I guess this is what... I just thought it was like a weird
joke.
What
the game's for.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But then now I realize that that was actually just to prevent people from stealing their shit.
Could be, yeah.
Yeah.
Although with the other part, like they also have you unplugging PlayStation controllers to continue a boss fight, so he might have just been having fun for the sake of it.
That's what I thought.
Or maybe even satirizing it on some level.
Mm-hmm. Like that's like kind of what my thinking kind of was. Way. Yeah.
Speaking of,
when are you going to play Frog Fractions, Keith? Not Keith, Wander.
Don't mention that game. I'm going to waste my time again.
I don't know. Someday.
There's always like tomorrow.
I'd like to, but...
Not in Wanderland.
Put it off forever.
Wanderland is covered in games.
Mm-hmm.
Never put off anything for tomorrow that you could put off for the day after tomorrow.
I'm good at that.
Damn, did everyone get their pet peeves? Oh, I didn't. Oh, I never mentioned one, actually. I hate padding. Like, severely hate padding in video games. When a game has finished iterating on its ideas and then just creates 17 rooms of consecutive repeat of the existing idea instead, I get really displeased very quickly. And so, like, that's... For me lately, and people have been arguing with me about this lately, but it's my opinion to stick with, I guess, is that I've been playing through Neo, and I think I mentioned this last podcast, like the way it contrasts against Dark Souls is that when you play a Dark Souls game, very consistently, all five Soulsborne series games have all been so good about pacing, like almost horrifyingly good at pacing. Like you go through the stuff and like, they will just use a thing in like three ways and like that's our ideas and then they move on with their lives and you go on to the next area and like they so rarely waste your time without some form of iteration on their ideas. And so like the games are surprisingly short, especially when you played them before and you're replaying them, but they're so cool to explore for that reason. Whereas Neo, once you're like a third of the way through the game, every level starts to feel like the same level, or and sometimes is literally recycled versions of the same level played backwards. And you just are fighting the same enemies in the same context. Like, they're not even they're not even, like, remixing their placements and groupings to make them interesting. Like, being like, oh, yeah, well, you've never seen this combination of enemies before. Like, that's not happening. And it's just more game for the sake of it. And that's a bummer. Like, I play, I'm disappointed when I play a game every game I've played so far in the Tales series, where every time, like, they have all this attention to, like, their story arcs and their character interactions and all their skits, and so much writing goes into those games. And the boss fights are, every single boss fight is a unique character model you've never seen before, and that in itself is a cool detail. But every dungeon is, like, one room repeating over and over again, as if they had a quota to make it exactly, like, 90 minutes long or something if you play through
it
from front to back.
I have no idea where that even came from them, because, like, I played Symphonia, and the dungeons were all unique.
Yeah.
With, like, interesting puzzles and whatnot. And I got to Zestiria, and I'm just like, that's it? Yep. Really?
Yeah, Tales of Zestiria, Tales of Berseria, Tokyo Mirage Sessions, Persona 4. Like, every dungeon would be one hallway or room repeating or alternating just over and over again for, like, 90% of the content. And I'm like... but this is the body of the game. Like, I get even, at least in JRPGs, the fighting takes place in an alternate reality where you do a turn-based fight thing that's separate from the level design. But, like, you want to have a level to explore. You never want to have that Pokemon problem where you're walking through a nondescript cave and you have a random encounter, and then you're like, oh, crap, which way was I going? Because everything looks the same, and then you go back out the entrance of the Pokemon cave, and you're like, what? No, I had to start over. I couldn't tell where I was going.
You described a problem that I forgot that I ever had. But what a problem it was.
It's when your content is so nondescript, you literally can't tell when you get turned around. Like, that's such a bummer to me.
Yeah, that actually ties it. Keith, you asked me before we started the podcast if I had something to talk about, and I didn't, and then I thought of something, cheating in video games.
Yeah, I was going to bring that up when you talked about save scumming. Yeah. I was going to transition to that, because you and Wander can get along with this. Like, when you have the moment of, like, I'm not quite having fun with this game, so let's flip that switch there, and now it's this game.
Exactly.
Yep. Oh, yeah, yeah. I will cheat flagrantly if it means actually enjoying
more
myself.
More fun. Yeah.
Well, like, with Dark Souls 1, we are cheating up constant humanity because, like, I don't want to, like, suddenly have our co-op series dry up because we're totally out of humanity. I guess let's go to a bunch of
grind for fucking humanity for like 45 minutes.
That's what happened to our Bloodborne series.
Again?
We literally ran out of the currency you used to summon each other.
Yeah, they fixed it eventually.
I'm a very busy man. I don't got time for that shit.
Yeah.
The thing is, if I think games are such a complex medium that parts of it you might enjoy and other parts you don't, but they come as a full package. Yeah. If you're given a choice to just toggle God mode. Mm-hmm. And that's how got through Skyrim the first time I played through the game.
Yeah, like, people balk at it, but there's a reason why narrative difficulty was added to Mass Effect 3, because some people just want to kind of sleepwalk through the combat and get back to the part that everyone actually buys Mass Effect for.
Yeah, exactly. I was actually talking about this in your Discord earlier today about, like, I kind of think there should probably be, like, a casual mode for the Dark Souls games, because...
I don't know.
Well, no. Like, we're playing co-op together for Dark Souls. That is casual mode to me, because I don't need to think or try as hard. And for me, it's an enjoyable experience, whereas playing Dark Souls solo is kind of just a lonely... And, like, it is a rewarding experience, but I don't have the time or the, like, mental... Well, maybe not mental capacity for that, but, like, I just don't want to put forward the effort to get the same experience that Keith gets out of it, because I don't enjoy that as much. You know, stuff like Rain World is a rare experience for me.
I'm so into it.
Yeah, I know.
I think that the whole point of Dark Souls, though, is that, like, if you go it alone, it's unnecessarily hard.
Yeah.
Like, in a weird way, I think it's a game about friendship.
But, like, there are people that, like, can't get that experience because they don't have, you know,
friends?
People that would play it with them and stuff like that. Yeah, like...
That was sad.
That's
for
why
for Dark Souls?
Yeah.
That's why it's so popular on YouTube, because people don't want to play through it, but they still want to enjoy it.
That's actually true.
Someone made a really strong argument at some point that, like, Dark Souls is all about this sense of camaraderie under, like, fire, basically. Because even if you don't have friends to co-op it with, like, the game is built around other people helping you beat it. Via, like, there's messages all over the floor that are both reliable and unreliable. There's people who you can have summon into your game to help you. There's even a covenant based around defending you when someone invades you. And then there's, like, this inherent vagueness to all the mechanics that encourages people to connect to each other online and create these shared resources, which is why Dark Souls has, like, the most comprehensive wikis I've seen for most games that aren't, like, I don't know, Pokemon or something. Like,
that's actually 100% my takeaway for the game, is that it's about that shared camaraderie.
Yeah, like, it's a game that the community beats, basically.
Yep.
Even if you play it alone.
It's kind of like golf. You're playing the course.
Yeah.
Not the people.
At some point, while playing through a Souls game, you look something up. There's some detail you need to find externally, to the point where every game has a borderline impossible to find hidden area that most people end up finding because they're like, oh, well, there's a list of bosses and I haven't found them all. Where are they? Like, it's like the equivalent of, like, Ash Lake in Dark Souls 1, where you had to beat down multiple hidden walls to get to a place, or, like, the weirdness that is,
I never would have found Ash Lake.
The garden, the Mad King's garden or whatever in Dark
Champion
Souls 3.
Yeah, Champion Gundyr in 3, or, what is it, there's some really weird stuff in 2 also, but like,
oh yeah, there is.
I can't even remember it right now, but in Bloodborne at some point you have to find an invitation somewhere, then take it to an obscure crossing somewhere else in the map, and it takes you to an entirely unique environment that's like instanced off from everything else in a way that makes it feel like the Artorias of the Abyss DLC for the first game, and it's just in there, just waiting for you to not find it.
I think it's
one way to put it.
I think it's fantastic that there are still games like that, because that's such a old school sort of way of making games, I think, where, because that's inherently around, it's as you say about sharing knowledge of the game, but it's also about replaying through the game so many times that you just, you know, on your 30th pass through the game, you just let me try this, and you find something completely new.
It brings back the schoolyard chats, basically.
Yeah,
it does, if you hold your Game Boy upside down and you mash the B button, you can get a 70% increased chance of capturing Mew.
Yeah, like, it's just...
Everyone had dumb stories about
I'll be right back.
Everyone had dumb stories about stuff you could do to your Game Boy to somehow increase your chance of catching things when you throw the Pokeball, and none of them
down
were true.
I still do that. It gives me something to do, man.
I would roll the D-pad... While holding A or something like that.
Because what are you going to do? Not do that? Like, you're just going to watch it? You freak? No. Down and B. Roll the D-pad.
Yep.
The only thing that worked was blowing on the cartridge. That's the only one that everybody knew instinctively.
So bad for your cartridges, though.
No, I think it actually... I don't know if it didn't work.
No, it's really bad.
It didn't work.
It's not good for your...
It's bad for them.
No.
Does it rust them?
It rusts the contacts.
Okay. Oh, yeah.
It doesn't work.
No?
What does work is actually you taking it out and putting it back in. Because it gets the schmutz off of the connections.
Mm-hmm.
And so everybody always thought it was, you know, blowing on it, but in reality it's just the act of taking it out and putting it back in that does the trick. Unless, of course, you actually have crap in there, at which point you dirty animal...
That was universally everyone's solution still. Like, everyone, independently. In the pre-internet world, everyone tried that same solution.
But that's normal. I mean, it's... Blowing works for everything. Is it too hot, the food that you're eating? Blow on it. Oh, does it hurt? Blow on it.
It's a natural way of trying to clean out a thing that's a cavity that you can't reach with anything.
Exactly.
I like to use my NES to hold my sandwiches between games. I'm going to play Super Sandwich World.
That reminds me of when games became digital only and people could just not buy discs anymore. Like, there was all those like cup holder jokes about the disc tray in consoles now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember those.
Did anyone have a mute voice? I don't remember if we got through everyone.
I
think we got through all of them.
Yeah.
I hate video games in general.
Yeah.
That's your pet peeve.
The problem is that they exist and they just stop.
Yeah, the problem is... I would like for them to not exist anymore.
Can you imagine any more questions? Can you imagine a game without a world without video games? Because the internet in itself is so... I mean, the people that made the internet were geeks. They are the ones that created video games. The internet exists because of video games for a lot of part. It's porn half and the other part is video games. But...
I think the internet exists because they wanted to make missile launches go smoother.
Well, that's the origins, but MMOs played such a big part in developing the internet as we know it today because they existed previous to the internet. Yeah, it's kind of interesting.
I should look into this, I guess.
Yeah,
I never thought of that.
Back, I think I don't know names, but I think it's back in 1992 or something. There was one in particular. Was it EverQuest? Was it Neverwinter?
I don't know. I'm not surprised if there is like a story out there of somebody developing some key internet technology that was optimized towards a smooth video game experience, but I haven't heard of that happening.
But not just the internet, even computers. Like, a big reason why we got MP3s and stuff like that was because of video games. There's a lot of advancements that just are made because there exist video games. It's a very important part of the world that, you know, it's hard to know if you don't know that bit, but they...
Well, I mean, that may be true, but we should also delete all video games.
Okay.
Control-A, delete. Done. Got it.
Chip delete.
I went to the Wikipedia page and I deleted video games.
Oh no, now I'm banned from Wikipedia.
Oh no. All right, Kaylin Demazier asks, dear members of the podcast, have any of you ever read comics, DC or Marvel? And if so, which ones? Where'd you start? And what is your favorite one or your favorite series? He also asked for advice on how to get into comics, but I don't know if anyone of us will have that kind of answer for them.
I have no idea.
I'm a huge comic book nerd, and I'm like super burnt out on them, which is kind of annoying.
Yeah.
So, I mean, the main trick with comic books is you figure out what publisher you like the most. Like there's only a couple of publishers out there, and like generally they all kind of publish similar stuff. Like Marvel and DC are very much about the syndicated, repetitive kind of stuff. Mm-hmm. And they don't really have much variety with their content after a while. But they're probably the easiest to get into. Dark
the
Horse
entire universe, so we can tell the same story again. Yeah.
Dark Horse generally has the better comics, quote unquote, mainly because they tend to have like beginnings, middles, and ends. And so it's kind of like it really depends on what you're into. I like Marvel for a lot of reasons, but you know, hundreds of beginnings and no real ends. But a lot of the comic sites nowadays, or the comic companies, have mm-hmm. like access to the online archives that you can buy into for really cheap. Like I know Marvel's $10. I think DC's $10. I don't know if Dark Horse has anything like that. And
does that let you just burn through the whole backlog or something?
Sort of.
Good luck doing that, though.
There are limitations.
You have access to them, at least.
Yeah. Yes. So, like, if you wanted to go read every single...
X-Men.
Yeah. X-Men. If you wanted to read every single...
There's so many.
Yeah.
There's so many.
Especially
in the 80s.
Mm-hmm.
If you wanted to read every single... Spider-Man, pretty much everything. The exception mm-hmm. is they don't have like more recent comics, if that makes sense. Like if you're looking mm-hmm. for like last month's, you know,
right,
then you're supposed to buy it.
Yeah, then you have to buy it, and they will sell it to you through those sites too. But yeah,
Dark Horse.
There's supposed to be a really weird thing going on right now with comics modernly, especially with Marvel, especially because they are now owned by Disney. And what's going on now with Marvel Comics specifically is that they don't really care how well they do, and they just throw ideas around, because basically at this point, the Marvel as a whole, so much of their money comes from comics, so little money comes from comics, that they don't really care anymore, so they just throw ideas around just to basically workshop future movies.
Mm-hmm.
That's basically the entire point of comics now for Marvel, is that they're just a subsidiary of being a future movie script.
Wow.
I don't know about Dark Horse. I mean, I'm from Portugal, so comics are going to be different here. But the only American comics, apart from Calvin and Hobbes, which I really love, the only
Asterix
American
and Obelisk.
I don't know that reference, but I read it in Portuguese though. But the only one that I read was in actually a Spanish translation of The Dark Knight Returns. Mm-hmm. And I'm looking it up, and it's from Frank Miller, which I recognize the name of.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Dark Knight Returns is great.
Yeah,
I love that one. That was amazing. But I never got anything like it, because the European comics are different, just fundamentally different. Even serials are... It's completely different, I find. I'm a big fan of... Blake and Mortimer, but that's... I don't know if it's still going, but it's old school stuff here from France. I think actually mm-hmm. that's from Britain. But if you're... touching on what you're saying, Wonder, the problem is there's so much to read, but if you stick with the clothes stuff, because The Dark Knight Returns is just a single story. It's there. It's all there from start to finish. If you stick to that and you just want to start somewhere, I think that's... I find that that's a good place to start, if you can then, you know, proceed with your hobby of reading comics, I suppose, maybe.
Yeah, for me, I've got super limited exposure to superhero comics because of the daunting nightmare nature of them, and because the continuity gets so convoluted mm-hmm. that they always inevitably lead to something very stupid happening in the story as a result of its own continuity. Like the
Eldritch gods, always.
Especially when people do an idea and then like that idea is not popular, so they have to retcon the idea with really bad ideas, yeah. Like the mm-hmm. Spider-Man clone saga.
Yeah, there's a lot
which
of those.
Was a thing that happened. So yeah. For me, my superhero comic exposure is a standalone spin-off compendium type things like Old Man Logan. But mm-hmm. by and large, I only really like to read instead non-superhero comics that are standalone books you just get as a single thing and it's over forever when you're done with it, like Scott Pilgrim or V for Vendetta or stuff like that.
Yeah.
And the only long-term comic I read is Walking Dead. Mm. And that's just, it's just a weird story and I just can't stop following it because I think I've talked to you guys before about what I like about Walking Dead over like normal zombie stories is that like it's like the Mad Max of zombie stories because instead mm-hmm. of like every zombie movie ever is like, here's the apocalypse happening. Will they survive these like 3 days after everyone becomes zombies? And then the credits roll when everyone dies or some magical cure happens or they escape the city or something like that. But mm-hmm. in Walking Dead, the main character is in a coma during the outbreak and wakes up after it. And the entire story for years and years is exclusively not the part of that you hear in every other zombie story. And it's this Mad Max style, like, the world's down, and it's just people surviving this apocalypse for a ridiculously long time.
I can totally relate with that appeal. That's one of the reasons why I love Fallout so much. Well, the original ones mm-hmm. were a little bit stronger on that one. Just, it's about the new world, not the old one. But it's still pretty cool when you go back and just see what was lost every once in a while. I don't have experience with Walking Dead, though, so I can't really say. But yeah, just people surviving in a new reality. That's, yeah, I can relate to that.
There's also like webcomics and stuff like that, but they kind of come and go, and it's very hard to. I don't know.
Now, yeah. Webcomics are a place to look for strange long-term comics.
Yeah, they are. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are some really good webcomics out there. It's just the problem is since they're always done by, you know, self-employed
labor of love type of thing.
Yeah, it's mm-hmm. it's labor of love,
which means they never want to put out pages till they're totally done, and you get like 12 pages of lackadaisy a year.
Yeah, well, lackadaisy is mm-hmm. was always kind of a special exception just beyond that, but mm-hmm.
how ridiculous is its modern art? Oh my
it's
god,
absurd. Yeah, lackadaisy is amazing. This.
Lackadaisy is like one of the best drawn comics I've ever seen, period, let alone just on the internet. But right up there is a Kill Six.
Right, it's this thing. Yeah. Oh my god, yeah, this thing's always looked good.
Right up there with Lackadaisy is Kill 6 Billion Demons. Is mm-hmm. a ridiculous webcomic with an insanely convoluted, like self-important story of this entire world realized by its author and crazy art style, and it's mm-hmm. it just keeps going. Like you go to the internet for labor of love stuff that no publisher is going to like mandate where storylines go or care about like what's popular with the audience and like just wacky stuff will start happening, but it might never get finished because it's yeah. one person making a thing.
Oh jeez, yeah.
That's the trade-off you get.
But then again, the never get finished. That's not really a problem. That's exclusive to webcomics. You have that everywhere else.
Prequel yeah. Adventure hasn't updated since October 31st. I should message Kazared.
Yeah.
Like, dude!
I was going to go check that out, and he...
Oh, crap.
Which comic?
And Prequel Adventure, it's Bird's friend, actually.
Yep.
Has a comic. And it was a comic that I read for a while up until his updates started getting a little
person.
Bit smart. Yeah.
Yep.
It's based on Morrowind, right?
Yeah, Oblivion.
Oh, was it Oblivion? Okay, it was hard for me to remember.
Oh god, talk about Labor of Love, it's an animated comic.
Yeah,
yes. It's Homestuck inspired.
Oh boy.
It's actually not bad. Like,
it's decent, yeah. I'm really proud of him for doing
it. You'd think
it
would be like a little bit cringy or anything like that, but it's actually like a really solid thing. The only mm-hmm. notable exception is...
He hasn't updated since October 15th, 2015.
Let's see if we can make the 2 years. He hasn't updated since like a couple months after Colonel started his channel. For just context of like age.
I killed him. I killed his work.
You are him.
Good job. Oh, good job. No, somebody had to do it eventually. Oh. You'll appreciate me saying that. We were really close, but I haven't spoken to him in like a couple of years now. I got very busy with school and just kind of fell off that radar. So I got five minutes.
I think we're ready to close it. Yeah. It's like 2 a.m. in the morning for Colonel.
Do you want to hear another wander farting story, or do you want to end on something better?
I mean, not wander farting story, but I've been going to the gym daily for the past like 2 weeks now.
Yeah, how's that working out for you?
I'm so hungry all the time now, and it is
You're so hungry that you ate Shell. That's why she's not here.
Yesterday,
you should probably explain why Shell's not here. I forgot to ever bring that up two hours ago.
Yeah, good point.
Shell's at Toracon, an anime convention in Rochester.
I thought Toracon meant it was about Hebrewism. How many conventions do you guys go per year?
We used to go to like six, but since we moved to Kansas, we've kind of rolled that back. It was a lot easier when we were in college because one of our friends. Literally, like, that was how she makes her living, mm-hmm. and that's how she paid her way through college. And she did, like, mm-hmm. you know, sexy anime boys kissing and stuff like that, and like, there's a huge market for that. And so she would just make, you know, hundreds, if not thousands of dollars doing that. And we just kind of follow along, you know, watch her table, and maybe sell, you know, a couple hundred dollars worth of random artwork slash, like, Pokemon buttons, because we're both really good at drawing like adorable Pokemon, which is comically easy. But now we've just
given them
brought
Disney
it back
eyes.
Down to two. Yeah. So we went to the one locally here, which actually made Shell like $2,000, which she was surprised by because she was like really nervous about it. Because for the most part, we were always just riding this other girl's coattails. So suddenly, like, we're kind of off on our own here. And so we weren't really sure if like we were going to, if we were going to be okay or not. And then Shell's making bank. But yeah, so she's at Toracon, which is in Rochester, New York. And cause her parents live there too. So it's like super easy to justify going.
Mm-hmm. Well, you know, let Shell know that I wish her a happy, Sabbath. You know, Shalom and all that. And, hope she has a good Toracon.
I was going to play Doom today, and I forgot. Felt bad about that.
What?
You know, playing, like, a game about shooting
Doom
demons on
like
Easter.
Eastery?
Oh.
Yeah, exactly.
I can think of nothing more Eastery than, like, oh yeah, happy Easter, everybody.
Let's play Doom.
But not Colonel RPG, because his Easter's already over.
Does it work out? Yeah, well, timing, I guess, yeah. Time zones!
Yeah.
I managed
to eat a whole box of Ferrero Rocher and in 6 hours. I showed it actually earlier.
Oh man,
that's why I'm not going to leave it to be 150. it's rare, so it shouldn't be much of a problem. I don't eat. I do like my sweets, but I don't eat them too often, so it's not too bad.
That's good, because if you kept that up, you would be the next Wilfred Colonel RPG.
Yeah. Yep.
All right, so to close this out, you can find the audio version of this podcast at soundcloud.com/4nerds. You can send us questions at 4nerdsquestions@gmail.com. If we haven't answered it yet, we may in the future. We definitely have a bit of a backlog. You can find my channel at youtube.com/SebastianSB. Wanderbot is at /wanderbots with an S. Birdcatcher is Birdcatcher Games, and Colonel RPG, I don't think has a custom URL, but there'll be a link in the description, or you can search Colonel RPG.
It's Colonel RPG Gaming.
Yeah.
You have your shit together tonight, Keith. Good job.
I was opening tabs and prepping things. You said it's Colonel RPG Gaming?
Yeah, it's weird. You too.
Yeah,
I can't do it.
All right. But yeah, thank you all for watching tonight.
Thank you very much for having me.
Thank you in the future.
and if you subscribe to me and Wander and Colonel RPG, then you can get approximately 20 videos about RPGs per day.